Well, hi everybody, this is Paul Fisher from the University of Florida IFAS Extension, and it's a real pleasure to introduce Dr. Sarah White today. Sarah led a large group of researchers from many different universities, and she's a leader in water quality management. And she's going to talk to us today about pesticides, water quality, and the effect on our bottom line. And Sarah is a nursery extension specialist and professor at Clemson University in the plant and environmental sciences department. So welcome, Sarah, and I'll hand it over to you.
Thanks, Paul. It's definitely a pleasure to be here today and to get to talk to you and to everybody who eventually watches this about pesticides and how water quality influences how they do what we want them to do. So sort of the first step in thinking about pesticides and water quality is actually knowing where your water source is. If you're pulling from a surface water, or if you're recycling irrigation water, or if you have a groundwater source, each of those sources will have different just baseline chemistries that will influence how effective your pesticides are. And so the first thing you need to do, and Paul talked about this in the first of these seminars that we gave, these 5 and 5, is the water quality and how you actually measure and manage water quality. And so the WaterQual app that's on the cleanwater3.org website is one of those things that can be a very helpful tool to help you understand what your water quality is. So one of the first things that I think about when I'm thinking water quality and what's really the most critical component, well, one of two most critical components of water quality is pH. So dependent upon the pesticide that you're using, most are actually stable with spray solutions at a pH of 5 to 6. But some of these same pesticides decompose at pHs greater than 7. And so if you look at this figure, what you're seeing is that scale of pH from 0 to 14, which you always hear about. Typically, when we think about things related to horticulture, we want our pH range to be about 5 to 7, maybe 7.5, depending upon what our base water quality is, because it's most usually most nutrients are available at that pH range. But again, most of our pesticides are also most effective in that range. When you start veering off of that range and you start getting below 5 or you start above 8, you're seeing some extreme differences in just what ions are freely present in the water. And in those, the presence of either excess hydrogen ions when your pH is too low or excess hydroxide ions when your pH is too high can really influence how your pesticides are working. So one of the first things that we learn to think about is looking at that safety data sheet to get an idea of the pH of your pesticide. So for this example, that ideal pH range is about 5.5 to 6.5. And then if you're really lucky, the label is actually going to give you some information that might help you make an informed decision about whether your water quality is going to be ideal for their product or not. And this one actually says, do not use this product in water with pH values above 8 unless a buffer is added. But we're not always that lucky. So when we think about how pH influences this, we also need to think about that half-life or how long that pesticide is going to last in that form with the most active ingredient available as influenced by pH. And so a half-life is kind of a technical term. Sometimes you may see a T50 on a label or a safety data sheet if you actually look at those, which I know all of you are because you're supposed to before you use the pesticides. But either way, when they have some of these half-lives, it's the amount of time that that pesticide will stay active. So if your T50 or your half-life is 7 days, you're golden. It doesn't matter really when you apply it, although it's really ideal to apply it right after you mix it. But if your half-life is, you know, as depending upon pH, a little shorter, then it becomes quite a bit more critical to actually be planning ahead and to know that when you're mixing your chemicals based on what your pH of your mix water is, when you're going to apply it. So there's a few examples here of like carbaryl. Carbaryl, if your pH is 6, it's going to be stable for 100 plus days. If your pH is 7, it's 24 days. If your pH is 8, it's 2 to 3 days. If your pH is 9, it's 1 to 3 days. I mean, and this is dependent on temperature, it's some other things too, but some of our pesticides are really, really sensitive to pH. So it behooves us and it's really worthwhile to sort of keep a track of is my pesticide, when I'm applying it, actually doing what I think it's supposed to do? And if it's not, and it does one day and doesn't another day when you apply it, perhaps there is some influence of water quality, and that may be one way you could actually figure out what you need to do. And so what that component of water quality that is influenced by pH is what we refer to as alkaline hydrolysis. If your pH is too high or you have too much hydroxide, that OH ion that we talked about initially, in your water, some of these, the pesticide chemistries, the bonds that are holding that chemistry together that make it achieve a certain target to get the control that you want will sometimes break. And so when that pesticide breaks down, you have much less of that active ingredient that's actually available in the water to do what you want to do. So the pesticides are actually degraded from their active forms into inactive forms, and hopefully inactive forms that are less toxic than the initial form. But so how quickly these pesticides degrade depend upon pH, the chemistry of the pesticide, how long that the pesticide stays in the spray tank, as well as the temperature. On a really hot day, your pesticide is going to degrade faster than if it's a cooler day. So that might be another consideration for you. And then you can always look at the safety data sheet in the label for pH stability information, because pesticides that are sensitive to this kind of thing typically have these have statements. But sometimes it is dose dependent. If you have a, you know, 1.5 ounce versus a 3 ounce application rate, 1.5 ounce, you may not actually get the activity you need, but the 3 ounce rate might. So it's really dependent upon what you're trying to manage. But those are still within the label rates. I'm not telling you to double it. If your water quality is poor, I'm not telling you to double what you're adding to it to get what you need. It's a lot cheaper to actually manage your water quality. So let's think about this. So when is water pH suitable for pesticide mixing? So if your pH is 3.5 to 6, for most pesticides, when I say pesticides, that's the all-encompassing herbicides, fungicides, and insecticides. Maybe even some growth regulators get thrown in there in that mix. Most of them can be sprayed and stored for 12 to 24 hours. However, there are some herbicides that are susceptible to degrading when the pH is too low, these sulfonylurea herbicides. So just be aware of what your pesticide's chemistry is, and that will help you determine how you need to buffer your water, whether you need to make it more alkaline or whether you need to make it more acidic. If your pH range is 6.1 to 7, spray it almost as soon as you mix it, within 1 to 2 hours. You don't want to store this because you don't want to have this something that would be effective in the first hour of spraying, and then you go on a lunch break and you come back 2 hours later and finish spraying out your tank, and you have differential efficacy of your product. And then if your pH is above 7, or if you have a really sensitive pesticide, really consider adding a buffer or acidifier. And so that gets us to the next point, that point five, is how do I modify water quality? So depending upon your operation and the mix of plants that you grow, among other things, you can consider acid injection. It's one of those tools that helps your whole plant product line, as well as your pesticide efficacy. But if your plants are growing fine and you're not worried about it, and you just want to control the pH in that mixed tank where you're actually mixing your chemistries, then think about buffering agents. And buffering agents are chemicals that will actually reduce or raise the pH to the point that you want it and then hold it there just because of the ions that are in that mix. And so there's a few different kinds. And one of the interesting ones to think about is the color changing ones. And you'll notice that's on this label here, you see different colors from the white to the peach, to the yellow, to the red. Eventually, if you know what pH range you're shooting for, the color of your water will change so that you know which range is the right range. And so depending upon what you need to do, this works. But realistically, spray immediately after you mix. So if you're going to spray in the morning, spray it all out, spray the entire tank out, or mix half of the volume if you don't think you're going to do it, manage to finish it out in the morning and you need to do the next time. But always check the label, because your label is going to tell you, generally speaking, whether it's sensitive or not. Then again, keep a log of what you do. Because if you're writing down, I mixed this chemistry with this water and I buffered the pH to this on this date, and then no comments because it worked like you wanted. And then we used the same chemistry at the same rate and we forgot to put the buffering agent and then it didn't work right. You have a better idea of what's going on. And you can do this for most of your chemicals and figure out which ones really need the buffer and which ones don't. Because sometimes the labels don't say that they're pH sensitive. So just sort of to sum it all up and give you that brief, broad overview, check the label and the safety data sheet for water quality compatibility issues. It may not tell you, but it might. So if you read it, you have that chance of finding out. Test your mixed water pH before adding the pesticide. Don't add the pesticide and then say, oh, I forgot to check it. Let me check it and see if I need to change it. Because chances are, if you do that, your pesticide, if it was sensitive, is already starting to degrade. And then you can modify the pH of that carrier water before adding the pesticide. Again, these are just the steps so that you make sure that your pesticide is as effective as it can be so that you're not wasting money by having your pesticide degrade. And then spray immediately after mixing and keep track of it. And then if you have any questions, please use the extension service in your state or contact me or Paul. I'm sure we're very, very happy to work with you in answering questions that relate to water quality. And cleanwater3.org is a great resource. There's lots of informational tools there to help.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Sarah. So am I right that usually the problem is a pH that's too high? That seems to be the most common situation you're discussing here.
Yes, it is typically that your pH is too high. And there are more chemistries that are sensitive to high pH than low pH.
And is there a way that a grower can do a test of mixing pesticides with their water to see in advance whether there's an issue? Or is it really just a matter that the grower really needs to own a pH meter? What would you suggest they do?
I would suggest that You can mix on site and look at compatibility issues if you're doing a tank mix, but you can't really tell if your product is degrading without owning a pH meter or having litmus paper, at least some way to do a quick and dirty, is my pH even close to the right range? The little pool strips that are within plus or minus 0.05 pH units, that's going to at least get you in the range to know if you're okay or if you're in the danger zone within that.
Okay. So some of these issues with pH, then they might not lead to precipitation to a solid like you might get with hard water. They're actually changing the chemistry.
Yes, that it is not. You're not going to see precipitation. You're not going to have a visual hint that the product's not going to work the way that you want it. It's really the pest that you're trying to control, or the fungicide, or the pathogen that you're trying to suppress may not be suppressed and may not be controlled.
Right. You mentioned Clean Water 3 and your extension agents and also getting in touch with water people like you and me. Are there any other articles or other resources that might be out there, fact sheets that perhaps we could link to this video?
Yes. Michigan State University actually has a very good fact sheet on alkaline hydrolysis and different chemistries. So that is one that I would look at as a very good resource.
Okay, great. Well, we'll find it and link to it in the description for this video. And thank you very much. It's great to see you. And this is really helpful information. And as you see it in your title, this is a way for people to get the maximum bang for their buck out of their pesticide application. So thanks a lot.
Thank you, Paul. It was a pleasure.